This is colorFabb's VarioShore TPU, a material that varies its softness by printing it at different temperatures because it foams up. I tested its properties with a pair of durometers, and we'll also take a look at the hardness of other 3D printing materials, and even how you can vary the softness of your parts without this special filament. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. A part of this video is sponsored by Audible. Support the channel and get your free audiobook by visiting audible.com/cnckitchen. Previously, we have already been taking a look at another one of colorFabb's foaming filaments, and that was lightweight PLA. By printing that material at temperatures of up to 250 degrees Celsius, you can lower its density by almost 60%, giving it a really nice texture and, more importantly, making it well suitable for things like RC airplanes, as, for example, Eclipson perfectly demonstrates. colorFabb uses a similar approach and adds a foaming agent, which is in the most simple case baking soda, to TPU. This foaming agent, that is finely distributed all over the material, is activated at elevated temperatures and releases a gas, for example CO2, and makes the material foam up in its molten state. The higher the temperature, the more gas is released. Hence, you can use the temperature to adjust the material's density. With lightweight PLA, this is used to make the material itself lighter, while still preserving some material properties. VarioShore TPU specifically uses the degeneration of mechanical properties when you lower the density. This results in very soft parts on printers that would otherwise not be able to handle flexible filaments, or even printing flexibles faster, because you generate more material volume in the nozzle and therefore the extruder doesn't need to work that hard. colorFabb sells VarioShore TPU on 700 gram spools, which usually cost around 50 bucks. Currently, the material only comes in natural and black. It doesn't look significantly different than other TPUs, with maybe the minor difference of the slightly rough and matte surface. This appearance is probably from the foaming agent or due to the lower temperatures they use during filament extrusion to not activate the additive while making the filament. I have the feeling that the slightly textured surface makes it less sticky, and I didn't even have issues printing it on an Ender 3, for example. Usually, I'd definitely recommend a direct drive extruder for most flexibles, but VarioShore TPU seems to be usable on Bowden-style printers as well, of course at low speeds. First, I had to tune the material, and in this case, I had to find the correlation between extrusion temperature and the flow I needed. To investigate that, I printed simple single wall parts. In the first iteration, the material flow for all temperature was set to 100% in the slicer, which of course leads to thicker walls at temperatures where we have foaming than the set 0.44 mm in the slicer. With those measurements, I started a second tuning iteration in which I already lowered the flow for each temperature according to the last wall thickness, with the goal to get all walls to the same dimension. Since the expansion coefficient depends not only on the temperature, but also on the extrusion rate, the second values were still not spot on. I again calculated new flow values, with which I ran a third test iteration, after which the walls of each temperature were pretty close to 0.44 mm. The final extrusion multipliers were 113% for the 190 degrees where no foaming occurs, and 57% for 220 degrees Celsius where we have the maximum expansion. Interestingly, at even higher temperatures, the expansion seems to be smaller. I don't have a definitive answer for that, but I assume that at elevated temperatures, the bubbles in the material get too big and partly collapse. Still, at the ideal temperature, this results in an expansion of 100%, so half the weight or double the volume as the base material, which is significant. Printing quality for normal models is mostly okay, but due to the foaming nature, stringing or material oozing during travel moves is inevitable, which can be a pain to clean up. Ridges also don't look great with my untuned profile. Everything else looks really great though. Smooth and matte surfaces with no layer lines and good overhangs. So if you design your part with this material in mind, and keep travel moves to a minimum, you might be able to produce some really nice looking parts. We have seen that we can foam up the material to twice the volume, but does this also mean that the material becomes twice as soft? To test the shore hardness variability of VarioShore TPU, I reached out to my friends at Mitutoyo and asked them if I could borrow two of their hardness testers, to which they kindly agreed. With such a durometer, you measure the indentation depth in a material created by a standardized indenter at a given force. The hardness of a material is then measured in shore hardness on a given scale that corresponds to a specific indenter and force. 100 shore means no penetration of the indenter. 0 shore means that the whole range of the tip indented the material. The most common hardness scales we're usually confronted with is shore hardness A and D. D is for plastics and harder rubbers and features quite a sharp tip, whereas type A is for medium and soft rubbers where a blunt tip is used. There is a range in which both scales overlap and theoretically both methods should work. In order to test the hardness range of VarioShore TPU, I printed a bunch of these small test plates that are 3 mm thick. The ISO standard for hardness testing asks for a minimum material thickness of 6 mm, so I always stacked two on top, which is specifically allowed. Let's start with shore D, so the scale for harder materials. You press the durometer on the material, ideally with a specified force, and usually read the measurement after 15 seconds. To get a feeling for that scale, let's start with standard 3D printing materials. PLA was the hardest with 78, then came ASA and Prusa's PC blend with 73, and PETG was even a bit softer at 70 shore D. My cutting mat is around 60 shore D. Then we made quite a big jump with 46 shore D for extruders medium hardness TPU. Next, we finally get to colorFabb's VarioShore TPU. Parts printed at 190 degrees Celsius when no foaming happens, measured in at 35 shore D. The samples printed at 200 degrees Celsius already were significantly softer at 25 shore D. And we further decreased the hardness at 210 degrees Celsius with 20 shore D. You can also definitely feel that with your hand when you just bend the material. The 190 degrees sample still feels quite firm, whereas the 200 degrees Celsius sample that's already a bit foamed up is way more compliant. Now it gets interesting because at 220 degrees Celsius we have seen the highest degree of foaming. Will this also be the softest sample? I measured 16 shore D and as expected, the sample printed at 230 degrees Celsius was already a bit harder at 19 shore D and on a similar level as the 240 degrees Celsius and 250 degrees Celsius samples. The only material I had that was even slightly softer was Diabase X60 TPU, which measured in at around 14 shore D, which is already interesting. X60 is soft like spaghetti and not the one cooked al dente. And I wasn't able to print it on my Prusa, not even to speak of a Bowden-style printer like an Ender 3. This material requires a special extruder for flexibles like the Omnia Drop, of which I have one on my E3D tool changer. So, if we print the VarioShore TPU at the ideal 220 degrees Celsius, we get almost the same level of softness, but it's way easier to handle. Think about that. I repeated the same tests on the shore A range, where the measurements are usually taken instantaneously using the drag indicator. I didn't even bother testing the standard materials because they are all outside the range. Extruder medium soft TPU was the hardest and measured 95 shore A. Then came all the VarioShore results. They were starting at 92 shore A for the samples printed at 190 degrees Celsius. The softest piece, again, was the 220 degrees Celsius one, with 65 shore A. The parts that were printed even hotter measured in at around 70 shore A. The black spaghetti, Diabase X60, tested just as advertised, at 59 shore A, so again just slightly softer than our 220 degrees Celsius VarioShore TPU. Pretty cool, what are your thoughts? So we were able to double the volume of VarioShore TPU by foaming it up, but does that mean that our hardness halved? Let's take a look at the shore A scale, which is the one that should be used for this material. We've previously learned that the shore hardness values correlate with how far the indenture went into the material. If we calculate the indentation depth from the measured hardnesses, we have 0.21 mm of indentation for the unformed material and 0.87 mm for the maximum formed level. This means that we not only doubled the softness, but even more than quadrupled it. Pretty cool, and again confirms the scaling laws for foams that say that foaming level and mechanical property are usually not correlating linearly, but at for example half the density, you lose more than half of the mechanical property. More on that in the lightweight PLA video. And if you find these investigations interesting, then also consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell. Let's now also quickly take a look at a way we can vary the softness of materials with simple slicer settings. 3D printing allows us to print parts with variable amounts of infill, which results in variable hardnesses for TPU parts. To quickly investigate that, I printed samples with different degrees of rectilinear infill in extruders medium TPU and measured the shore hardness. As expected, shore hardness A and D decreases with lower infill values, especially between 30 and 10%, reaching a softness almost comparable to the maximum foamed VarioShore TPU or Diabase X60. Though, this method is not always feasible because wall thickness and orientation will affect those values quite a bit. This investigation is by no means complete and different infill patterns will give you different results, but I think I could show you the general idea. So what's colorFabb's VarioShore TPU now good for? For once, I see it as a material that you can use if you want to print something really soft, but your extruder cannot handle spaghetti filament. Also, you can basically double your printing speed for flexibles because at the same feed speed of the extruder, twice the material comes out of the nozzle. Then the aesthetics with a nice matte surface finish might be a good base for painting because the color can grab into the surface and things like markers don't smear out like on other 3D prints. I can also think of special applications where you could vary printing temperatures within a model to create pretty exciting part properties, for example for shoe soles or bike grips. Then there's the density of the material. In the foamed up state, it is around 0.5 to 0.6 grams per cubic centimeter, which makes parts printed in this material quite buoyant. Especially interesting if you need to print something 100% dense, because you need to make sure that no water can seep into the infill. With its softness and therefore toughness, low density and close porosity, it might be a great material for parts that need to float and perform a function. Because many asked after the last video on foaming materials, I quickly wanted to find out if the parts really don't absorb water and not act like a sponge. For this, I weighed parts at different foaming levels before and after I submerged them in water for 14 hours. Even though the foamed up parts absorbed slightly more water, in this case 1% of their weight, they were not acting like a sponge. I suspect that the internal gas bubbles are mostly not connected, which makes it a closed cell foam. Therefore, this material might be a good solution for things that need to float and where you don't have to be afraid that your model absorbs water or leaks into it. Speaking of things that should or should not float, I just listened to an audiobook about submarine warfare in World War II called Thunder Below. I was really excited to hear the story because I also listened to a bunch of Tom Clancy audiobooks over the last years, especially noteworthy Red Storm Rising. Clancy goes into great details on today's submarine technology. Thunder Below by Eugene Fluckey with its World War II setting was especially interesting in contrast because I learned where the tactics and technology came from. Now here's the deal. Audible is sponsoring this part of the video and offers you a 30-day free trial in which you can listen to one of those or really any other audiobook completely for free. You'll also get access to their Plus catalog with more exclusive audiobooks, podcasts and other Audible originals. Support the channel and visit audible.com/cnckitchen, or if you're in the US, text cnckitchen to 500-500. Over the last months, I've been going on quite a lot of walks outside, where Audible's great selection of audiobooks always kept me entertained and educated. I really enjoyed Thunder Below, an exciting and interesting story about how the USS Barb revolutionized submarine warfare in World War II. Support the channel and get your free audiobook now. Just visit audible.com/cnckitchen or text cnckitchen to 500-500. No risk involved, and you can keep all of your audiobooks forever if you, at some point, decide to cancel the service. Thank you, Audible, for sponsoring part of this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're all doing well. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you subscribe for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, or use the affiliate links in the description. Go check out my other videos if you currently have more time than usual and want to educate yourself. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.